Christian joy. I want to speak to you on that subject some today with our text that we just read being the center for our thoughts. Likewise, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repented. We only read the first 10 verses of this chapter, but the whole chapter gives four stories that illustrate this truth. First of all, we see a lost sheep, and I'll talk to you about that in just a moment, described mostly in verses 4 through 6. And then after that, you'll see a lost silver piece in verses 8 and 9. And we'll talk to you about that in just a moment. And then there's a sinner, a lost sinner, mentioned in verses 7 and 10. And then one that we didn't read about is the lost son. The prodigal son is how he is known. Many of you have read the passage and heard it preached repeatedly, and we'll say a little bit about that in just a while. Let me encourage you, dearly beloved, to don't minimize the blessing and how special it is for one person to get right with God. For one person to respond to the Lord. I'll say that even with regard to people who are already saved. And that has some bearing on the fourth lost thing, and that was the lost son. Even with saved people, I will not call out names this morning, but for the short time that I've had the privilege of serving the Lord and serving you as your pastor, I won't call out any names, but just the fact that one of you that is seated here this morning joined the church, it was such a blessing to me. Amen. That if nothing else happened, the fact that you walked the aisle that time and said, "Pastor, the church will have me. I believe the Lord would have me to become a part of this church."
Amen.
That alone would be enough to keep me going. And I can focus on that and get a blessing.
Amen.
Now, you 99 just people need to learn to rejoice in that one.
Amen.
We know that we need people to stick. It breaks my heart when people don't stick. But we ought to get joy when one person makes a move in the right direction.
Amen.
And with you saved people, just the fact that I've seen some of you make changes in your life. With some of you, it's church attendance.
Right.
Seeing you come to church more often.
Amen.
Maybe with another, you've told me you're reading your Bible every day.
Amen.
Maybe with another, you're going on visitation. Whatever the step of growth and progress might be, I'll be honest with you, seeing that helps keep me going.
Amen.
When I focus on what some Christian has done and gone in the right direction, I remember it. I think about it.
Amen.
And I praise God.
Amen.
And then it gets even better, though. And you folks that have been here for a while, you need to thank God. We've got a number of people sitting in our auditorium that have gotten saved since you have been here. You ought to rejoice over every one of them. They're not going to all make it. They're not going to all last, but some will. And the ones that have gotten saved are saved.
Amen.
Regardless of what happens to them.
Yeah.
I've got people in this church that when you became a child of God under our ministry, I automatically, and I've got scripture backing for it, have also claimed you as my own child. And I feel obligated to watch over you especially as a father would a child. Doctrinally, the passage that we're reading shows the joy of seeing one of God's chosen people, the Israelites, get right with God. The main reference to lost sheep in the Bible is to straying Israelites. And that was to whom Jesus was sent when he came and ministered on the earth. Now, he has sent his disciples unto all nations in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, after he rose from the dead. But when he sent the 12 forth, remember that he said to them in Matthew chapter 10, go not into the way of the Gentiles. Aren't you glad that things have changed and the Lord's dealing with you Gentiles? He said, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans, enter not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That was Matthew 10, verses 5 and 6. Later on in Matthew 15, 24, Jesus said, I am not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Aren't you glad that the Lord died for everybody, though? And after his resurrection, sent the disciples to everybody.
Amen.
To try to win everybody. We find through the book of Acts that because of their hard-heartedness, that now that God deals primarily with Gentiles more than he does Jews, things have changed. But all humanity, all people of all races, are like lost sheep. As Isaiah 53 says in verse 6, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. You people seated here in the buildings of Glenwood Baptist Church in 2019, what a blessing that you straying sheep, the Lord knew ahead of time that you would need a Savior. The Lord knows all. And the Lord knew 2,000 years before you were born. Amen. Every wicked sin you would ever commit. And he laid those sins on his son. Just like I take my Bible or my hand and lay my hand on this Bible, all of your sins were future. And every sin, even the ones you've not committed yet, were laid on Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary.
Amen.
I believe that the application of this passage for us who are living after Calvary, where Gentiles are the main recipients of God's blessings and God's grace, is that there ought to be more rejoicing when a wicked person gets saved.
Amen.
Than when a person who's already saved continues to live right. We have to be careful, because from a practical standpoint, we know that a church cannot grow and stabilize and become strong like it should unless some people grow, stabilize, and become strong.
Amen.
But the truth of the passage is still there. The prodigal son, as we'll get to it, his brother was upset. He says, I've been here all the time. You didn't have to throw a party for me. He said, well, he says, you're always with me. We always have fellowship. Everything I got is going to go to you, son. But your brother was lost. Your brother was dead. He's been found. And he's alive.
Yeah.
Let's be happy. Let me encourage you, church. Grow. Grow strong. Be concerned about discipling these young converts.
That's right.
But never get over the joy of one of them making a step forward.
Amen.
You say, well, I don't know if he means it. You got to understand, these people are just getting born into the family of God. I mean, if you were to apply this to physical birth, do you know how stupid you'd look?
Yeah.
If you were down in the hospital, and you go there and you look in the nursery and you say, not saying nothing. He's not even saying thank you. You realize what it costs? He's not even saying thank you. That's a guy, by the way. Woman doesn't say that. He goes, he's not speaking. He's not even looking at me. He's looking at you. Okay? You'd look pretty stupid, wouldn't you? Expecting that child to say, I really appreciate the 9 months of labor.
Yeah. Yes.
Wouldn't it scare you if a kid really did say that in the nursery? You know, or maybe he had some kind of a computerized screen, you know, letting you read what he was saying through the nursery window, and it said, my gratitude knows no limits for the money that you have put into all of this, and for the money you're going to put into my college fund and all of that. No, we just look at them, and we're counting fingers, and we're counting toes, and we're looking, and we're rejoicing. When somebody comes down that aisle, I hope that we'll always be thankful that a lost person got saved.
Amen.
I want to title this morning's message, Joy Over Just One. Joy Over Just One. I will tell you, and this may sound like a paradox, I will tell you that I believe it is better to stay right than it is to fall and get right.
Amen.
But from this text, we learn that there is more rejoicing when somebody gets right because of the great need that that person has while they are in disobedience. Because of the emphasis in this passage on one sinner, I want you and me to emphasize today the priority of soul winning in the work of Glenwood Baptist Church. There are four comparisons made here in this chapter which show us the joy over just one. I'll list them for you. Number one, there's one sheep who is sought by a shepherd. One sheep sought by a shepherd. You'll see that in verses 4-6. And this shows us the waywardness of man. Man is like a lost sheep wandering around. What man of you having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep, which was lost. One of the things that brings joy to my heart is seeing new converts in our church. You new converts, I'll rejoice again as I see you grow and I see you stabilize. But what a joy it is to see just one. Just one! We've had numbers get saved in recent weeks and months. Man is like a disobedient sheep. Isaiah 53, verse 6, I just read it to you. And we need to remember that people are like a deceived sheep. One of the reasons why the sheep go in the wrong direction is they have been deceived by the devil. Amen. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 4, verses 3 and 4, that their minds have been blinded by the god of this world. Amen. Folks, they haven't seen the light yet until they get saved.
Amen.
They're deceived.
Yeah.
They thought that what they were doing would bring them happiness. They thought it would bring satisfaction. Some of them thought that was the only way they could survive. They were wrong.
Yeah.
But they were wrong because the devil deceived them.
Amen.
They were disobedient. They were also deceived. And folks, regardless of the age, we need to remember that a lost person is a doomed sheep.
Right.
We need to pray for children that are lost, middle-aged people that are lost, old people that are lost. They're doomed if you and I don't get the gospel to them. That's what our church is all about. May you people that have been in our church for a while never lose a vision, not just of filling the building. Thank God for the crowd we've got here today. People missing. Thank God for the group we've got here today. It's good. But the numbers of people in a building is not what we're talking about. It's the number of people that get saved because of the efforts of this church. That's what we're talking about. Getting people, I want to get people in the church building. You people understand that as a preacher, I like lots of folks being here?
Amen.
I like it. But that's not our mission. There's nothing in our mission that says, be sure we get as many people in these pews as we can. That's not the Great Commission. But the Great Commission is for us to get out there and witness. Baptize those who get saved. Teach those that we baptize how to live for God. That's what church is all about. One sheep. Then the next illustration in verses 8 and 9 is one silver piece. Now some of you that are misers, I can really hope that you can identify with this. You got a whole bunch of money, but you lose one silver piece. Either one woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, does not light a candle, sweep the house, and seek diligently till she find it. Still got a lot of silver. She's not satisfied with that one missing. It's the value of it, you see. And the silver piece, the sheep that's lost, shows the waywardness of a sinner. But the silver piece that was lost shows the worth of a soul. Shows how valuable, shows the worth of a soul. Amen. She's not satisfied because of how important that silver is to her. Darkness must have surrounded the silver piece because we read, what she do? She lighted a candle. You know what that implies? There was darkness around the silver piece. Gotta find it. It's in darkness. Unsaved people are in darkness. Don't magnify the darkness. Light a candle.
Amen.
The darkness is going to magnify itself. It's everywhere. Never seen it so dark in America as it is today. I'm not going to major on it, telling how dark it is. Let's get the gospel out. Because the light of the world is Jesus. Unsaved people are in darkness. They've got darkness in their hearts. They've got darkness in their homes. Their homes are a dark place. They have darkness in their humor. Darkness surrounded the silver piece. Dirt had stained the silver piece. Not only did the woman light a candle, but she swept the house looking for it. So not only was darkness a problem, dirt was a problem. She didn't want to be covered up with dirt. When I was a little boy, sometimes my mother had to wash me down just to be sure if I was a neighbor's kid or her kid. I was a natural boy. I'd get out there and I'd get dirty. Put me on a pair of shorts during the summertime, I was all... I come back in, I look like Brother Mark. I was covered, I was brown. I loved mud.
Amen.
Yeah, it's cool. You don't understand, mud's cool. I can understand. I can sympathize a little bit with pig. Unsaved people get involved in all that junk because it feels good to them. That's why they do it. They think that it's going to make them really happy. They say, this feels good. This must be good because it feels good. It's only until you get some years on you that you realize that what you thought felt good is hurting you. Gives you hangovers. Rots your teeth out.
Amen, preacher.
Burns up your brain.
Yeah. What brain?
Makes you make stupid choices.
Amen.
Encourages you to say wrong things.
Yeah.
Encourages you to have a bad personality. A lot of times you get involved in stuff. Darkness surrounded the silver piece. Dirt stained the silver piece. But determination secured the silver piece. She sought diligently till she found it.
Amen.
She didn't give up. And she rejoiced. I wish I was a better soul winner. And it's discouraging when you go on visitation and the people don't show up when they said they would.
Amen, preacher.
It's discouraging to go on visitation and not see anybody get saved. But if you'll stay with it and be diligent as a woman would look for that small silver piece because of its worth. If you and I would go after sinners thinking about how much they are worth, then eventually we'll get one. If you can get one and I can get one, before you know it, we'll have a bunch.
Amen.
The third illustration in the 15th chapter is a sinner. And in verse 10, it says, "Likewise I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth." Verse 7, put it this way, joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. And this shows us the will of God. One sinner sought by God. One sheep sought by a shepherd, showing the waywardness of man. One silver piece sought by a woman, showing us the worth of a soul. And one sinner sought by God in verses 7 and 10, showing us the will of God. That is, God goes after sinners. Christ Jesus came into the world. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief, the Apostle Paul wrote. I want you to notice, when we think about the sinner that is sought by God, I want you to notice, first of all, the desertion of the saved. At least, if they're not careful, the 99 will think that the shepherd doesn't care about them. And if you're not careful, you'll be like the prodigal son, who thinks that the father has no use for you, and he's spending all of his care and attention on the wayward one. Truth is pastors and churches spend a lot of time trying to go after people, whether lost or saved, that are wayward. Once somebody starts coming to church regularly, you may find nobody visits you as much anymore. You say, wait a minute, they were coming to see me all the time when I wasn't coming. Now that I'm coming all the time, they don't come see me.
Amen, preacher.
That's the illustration that's given there. Is the 99 don't need somebody to come looking for. They've been found.
Amen.
They're in place. I visit some church members more often than they visit the church.
Amen, preacher.
It ain't right. If you're saved, you ought not to have to be prodded, pampered, pled with, and petted in order to get you to come to church. The Lord did it anyway. We see not only the desertion of the sheep, or at least it looked like it, but we see the diligence of the soul winner. You remember that woman, she made diligent search. Soul winning requires diligence. We need to really try hard. Keep tracks in your pocket. Keep tracks in your vehicle. Keep a New Testament where you can get to it. That is diligence. Then we see here the delight of the Savior, because the Bible says that when he is found, when that sinner gets right, that God rejoices. It makes me think that God gets happier not just with a building full of people, but when the church people get people saved.
Amen.
Even if it's just one.
Amen.
I'm thankful for what we've seen happen, and I'm thankful for when we have big days. But it's all about a church getting the gospel of Jesus Christ out to unsaved people. And the last illustration is the prodigal son. One son sought by the father. Sheep was sought by a shepherd. Silver piece sought by a woman. Sinner sought by God. And in the passage we didn't read, verses 11 through 32, the prodigal son, a son sought by his father. You know what this shows us? It shows us the way home. It's possible for somebody to come back to God by recognizing where they are, remembering what they heard, and resolving, I'll go back. The story of the prodigal son, verse 32 says, it was meet that we should make merry and be glad. For this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. Just like I said in the introduction, that there's lessons we can learn about Israel returning to the Lord. Probably the most appropriate lesson we can learn is about a child of God who is a son returning from a backslidden condition. But for our purposes today, I believe it's included in this for us to realize that it's a great illustration as well, even though it doesn't match up all doctrinally. It's a great illustration as well of a lost person coming home to God, coming home to the God of his mama, coming home to the God of his daddy that was saved, and saying, I want that same family.
Amen.
That son, that prodigal son, he lost a lot. But he didn't lose his willingness to come back. There's some people who just seem so hard and untouched. They almost seem untouchable. But he got there recognizing where he was, and he still had that willingness to come back. And he still remembered the way home. The son was willing. The sad father was still watching. When the boy headed back, that father came running. Don't you ever forget that in the eyes of the father, the sibling was wrong in envying the attention. When somebody gets saved, let's make a big deal out of it. When the preacher emphasizes soul winning visitation, don't get to envy anything that anybody's doing. Be thankful, because that's what it's all about. Do what you can. One visit is better than no visit. A phone call is better than nothing. A letter, an invitation that you give to somebody in your neighborhood, a tract that you pass out, is better than nothing. But don't minimize the energy and the effort that we put forth into telling people about Jesus Christ. Everybody ought to know. Everybody ought to know. Everybody ought to know. Jesus is. Will you stand with me, please? Heads bowed.